Hello. Tonight on FanZone, we'll be talking about the Euros and England versus Wales.
I'll talk to former Sunderland captain Gary Bennett and many more things to come along the show.
So stick around because you don't want to miss it.
Hello and welcome back to the show, and football's back, and what a couple of weeks it's been for the beautiful game.
We've got plenty to get through over the length of the show, so let's take a look at these. Over and over many setting suns, I have run, I have waited for the rain to come. When through the mist I see the shape of you, and I know that I'm in love with you.
That was, of course, someone who's rose to fame over the past few weeks, Cal the Dragon, as he goes by.
He's a sensational keeper, Dom. He really is.
I know. Not a single Gardenhome has yet to score past him, so he's just a magician, isn't he?
The Garden El Clasico. What a game.
I heard he's getting a trial with a Sunday League club and they're agreeing personal terms with him. Did you hear that?
I wonder what his wage will be.
Who knows?
McDonald's chips.
If he's lucky. I heard Southgate's got his number.
He probably does, in all fairness.
I wonder if he'll get a place on the plane for the Euros, huh?
He probably could. He's better than Dean Henderson, apparently.
Really?
Apparently, so he says.
That's a bold, bold statement. But let's get into something a little more exciting. It's international tournament year. The only time that anyone ever cares about national team matches. But who cares? Because football fever just takes over the globe, doesn't it?
Yep, well, let's just remind ourselves of the groups, eh?
There's some interesting groups in there. I've got my eye on Group F. That's a difficult, difficult group.
Yeah, that's definitely the group of death this year.
If I was Hungarian, I would not be looking forward to the summer.
Yeah, you're going to get trounced in that group, aren't you? It'll be interesting to see who actually makes it out of that group, in all fairness.
I know, there's three really good teams in there, and they'll just be wondering who's going to miss out. Obviously, you've got Denmark and Finland, a Scandinavian rivalry, and you've got England versus Scotland in there, another...
Hopefully not a repeat of what happened to us in the Euros a few years ago against Wales, eh? Let's hope not, anyway.
Well, with England involved in another Battle of Britain, we hope not to have a repeat of what happened between England and Wales in 2016. So we decided we're going to determine which nation's the best with a England versus Wales penalty shootout.
Yes, the stage was set, football returns, national pride at stake, a battle of presenters, and what does he decide to do?
I may have decided to pick up a knock.
He gets himself injured. Absolute classic, but not to worry, as we found a fitting replacement to take his place in the shootout. And nobody could have predicted what was to happen next. Your commentary comes from Andrew Flatterson.
Hello everyone, and welcome along to a mild and windy Dorlonco Villa for a Anglo-Cymru clash in a classic penalty shootout. We see our players there. Representing the Three Lions is Jamie Eddy, standing in for the injured Joseph Hogg. And our very own Dominic Aberdeen is flying the flag for the Dragons. As he is the only presenter in attendance, Aberdeen and Wales will be getting us underway. Oh, well, what a beautiful display there from the goalkeeper. Showing respect before the contest is just a thing you love to see. Aberdeen running like a stick man. And fires a top corner. What a penalty to start us off here. The run-up was initially questionable, however, it seems to be efficient. The goalkeeper was left-rooted. Eddie placing the ball down on the spot for his first kick of the day. The goalkeeper attempting to make himself look big. Oh, and how cheeky was that of Eddie to place a no-look right into the bottom left. The keeper was ever so close to it, but no cigar. fact brought down to his knees and praying for forgiveness there, it seems. Hopefully he can make up for it in the rest of the contest. Here comes Aberdeen to put the ball on the spot for his second kick, and some interesting distraction method here by the man between the sticks, or rather on the sticks, should I say. Trying his best to put off his opponent as much as he can. Little tribute to MJ there. Touch of class as always. But Aberdeen sees the keeper moving and sends the ball rolling down the middle. Clever tactic there by Aberdeen to give the keeper the eye and have a wide space to gently roll it down the centre of the goal. Appears the outlandish diversions were just not good enough. So, how will England respond? Eddie also giving the goalkeeper the eyes, sending him the wrong way and planting yet another great penalty into the bottom corner of the goal. Our microphones pick up there and applause from the Welsh. We love mutual recognition in the game. These two, of course, former teammates from the Brandon Athletic days. Here comes Aberdeen again. The goalkeeper once more attempting to put him off with his moves, but he returns with a stance of his own. And, oh, smacks off the frame of the goal. There was some power behind it. And if there wasn't much flight in the ball, the goalkeeper was going the other way. We see here again the ball soaring at the crossbar. We have our first miss here. Can Eddie capitalise on his opposite numbers miss? Yes, he can. Doing what Aberdeen couldn't in keeping it under the bar, but still hitting it with some power to make it soar into the roof of the net. However, it can be argued that the keeper's awareness should be better today. Nevertheless, England have the lead. Aberdeen hoping to make up for his mistake earlier on, as he chips it into the side of the netting, sending the keeper to the shops in the process. He's still in this game as he whips out the old Guernsey special, with Eddie joining in too. They celebrate together, but if Eddie slots on this fifth penalty, then the victory will be England's. One kick determines this game. Eddie with a peculiar run-up, which he... Oh, places just over the bar. Well, well, well. England failed to capitalise, but only just. How close was that? Wales led off just about as we go into sudden death. Can Aberdeen make use of his lifeline? Oh, what's this? Oh, my word! Aberdeen scores and Wales lead once more. Looks of shock on the faces of all on the field. How on earth has he snuck that in? He tried something a little outlandish. It wasn't the cleanest of executions, mind you, but regardless, it has ended up in the back of the net. The goalkeeper not quick enough to get down to it. Aberdeen cannot believe what he's just witnessed. An absolute howler from the keeper, which might have just cost Eddie the game. One huge kick ahead of us, which is... saved? No! Eddie scores, which means we go on. Two penalties which really should have been light work for the goalkeeper, and they both just want to get on with it. Aberdeen going for a quick run-up as he hits it into the back of the net. A simple-as-you-like penalty, which also doesn't help an argument for this keeper. He has had an absolute blunder all day, and if he wishes to redeem himself, he must save this decisive penalty. Eddie knows he must score to keep this alive, which he doesn't. We see our first proper save from a man who is supposedly in goal, which not only sees the contest over, it hands the bragging rights also over to Aberdeen and Wales. The winner once again busting out the signature move. Let's have a look at that winning penalty once more, as well as some other of his highlights from this tight, tight contest. There was times when he looked down and out, but the odds seemed to be in his favour. And here's that controversial penalty from early on. How he hasn't saved that is beyond me. You call it presenter tax, we call it football. It finishes here. England 3, Wales 4.
Heavens above, did you see that barnet up there?
No, it's
insane, really. I mean, just saying, if I wasn't injured, you'd have been beaten there.
Yeah, well, you are, so remind us to get better goalkeeper next time. Right, we're going to go for a quick break. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back. Should we talk games for a minute?
Well, it's FA Cup semi-final weekend, isn't it, Tom?
It is, isn't it?
City take on Chelsea and Leicester take on Southampton.
Two big games them, isn't it?
Yeah, well, you fancy one of the underdogs to obviously maybe win in the final, you know.
My money's on Leicester, you know.
Leicester, probably.
My money's on Leicester to win the whole thing. Like, yeah, City look unstoppable and Chelsea love a good cup run, but Leicester have it in them. They have a talented squad.
They do. Iheanacho firing at the minute as well.
Exactly.
You know, but the other game, City Chelsea.
That'll be one to watch.
It will be.
That'll be a good one.
Both obviously progressed in the Champions League this week.
He didn't. It didn't look like City were going to go through, was it? With Jude Bellingham.
Oh, it was a great strike, wasn't it?
Making it difficult for him, wasn't he?
Yeah. Well, he should have scored in the first leg as well, didn't he?
Very true, but VAR being VAR, it's games like that that make you wonder, like, what it's going to be like for City once Aguero leaves.
Yeah, but I mean, where's he going to go, though?
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
I don't see why they're not extending his contract.
He's a great striker. He's just been injured this season, hasn't he? So
he's been very unlucky. He's contributed so much to the club, especially in the modern era.
Yeah.
That iconic goal in 2012 against QPR.
Obviously, well, you can't dispute it. He's the greatest, well, probably the only striker of note in their club's history.
Exactly. He's one of the greats, especially in Premier League era.
Certainly.
They must be eyeing up a striker, someone on the likes of Kane, surely.
Oh, must be eyeing up Haaland, Kane. You know,
they've got to have a big name to replace him.
They've got a big transfer kitty.
Of course.
They've got to be eyeing up someone big.
Right, on to something a little bit different and something we both find very exciting as Sunderland fans.
Yeah, a couple of weeks ago, Dom had the great opportunity to interview Gary Bennett, the former Sunderland player.
Gets the 1-2, but Bennett scores! It's 4-2!
Lee, Kelly wouldn't be looking to time his run. Robert Lee.
So, I'm here with Sunderland legend and former captain, must I say, Gary Bennett. Gary, how are you today?
Not bad, thank you. Been better, a bit tired, but that's due to work.
Obviously, you started your career and you were born in Manchester. So, I just want to ask you, what got you into football growing up on the streets of Manchester around the 1960s?
I think it's a sport which everybody wants to get involved in, especially boys. And I followed in my brother's footsteps. He was also a professional footballer at Manchester City. And I wanted to go down the, shall we say, the same pathway. Obviously, Manchester United and Manchester City were two huge, huge clubs. They had a lot of good players who played for both clubs. Obviously, Manchester United had the likes of Dennis Law, George Best, Bobby Charlton. And Manchester City also had the likes of Francis Lee, Dennis Stewart, who's also played there. Colin Bell, and everybody wanted to obviously idolise them and wanted to follow in their footsteps.
I wanted to ask, as a man who's never got to experience the iconic row of Roker Park, I was only born in 2003, so how did the two grounds differ? Like, what was the transition period like between moving from Roker Park, such an iconic English stadium, to something modern like the Stadium of Light?
Well, you look at Roker Park, obviously, you know, it's deep in history. You know, it's iconic, shall we say, Roker Park, especially a night game. You know, it's famous for the Roker Roar, which, you know, was unbelievable. Put the hairs on the back of your neck when you played in a night game on a freezing night and the supporters get right behind you. But you again, you know, it's maybe the standing situation played a big part as well to the atmosphere at Roker Park, which is totally, totally different to the Stadium of Light. You know, you're looking at the Stadium of Light, which is a 48,000 all-seater stadium. And, you know, we've been trying to get that sort of Roker Roar or the atmosphere at the Stadium of Light. But no, there's nothing what can beat a night game at Roker Park. You don't actually need to be in the stadium. You could be on the seafront and you could hear the roar. That's just before a game, before a ball is kicked.
You've obviously still worked with each other today at BBC Newcastle. You were at Darlington together as well. I'd just like to know, what's it like sharing a dressing room with a talent that is Marco Gabbiadini?
And goes Gabbiadini! It's a thrilling goal for Sunderland!
You want the good points or the bad points? No, again, you know, Marco, a fantastic player. He came from York, very unknown. Nobody knew about him. I didn't know nothing about him as well. It was a signing from Dennis Smith, who was rebuilding the team at the time. He brought in some good players like John McPhail, John Kay came in. We had Kevin Ball who came in. So he was a little bit of an unknown, Marco Gabbiadini, but he was a very exciting player. He had everything. You know, he was very good in the air. He was quick and he could score goals out of nothing. And, you know, that partnership which he was able to form with Eric Gates, you know, was fantastic. You know, the so-called G-Force, it was called then. And you've got to say that they played a big, big part, obviously, in Sunderland getting promotion.
I wanted to slightly touch upon a very iconic moment for a lot of Sunderland fans that involves you. I wanted to talk about a certain incident with David Speedy.
Chase out. Free kick against Bennett for that. And up the touchline and into the crowd goes David Speedy. And there really is no need for this.
Yeah, it's a very infamous moment at the time. And also now you look back at it and as well, you know, for me, it was just one of them where it was a reaction from myself. But you've just mentioned that it's an iconic moment for Sunderland supporters, myself, and that's something which is always brought up. I think the clock stand itself only held 8,000, but I've had about 28,000 people who said they were there, who was in the clock stand. So, yeah, it's one of them iconic moments. What happened, obviously, the incident, what happened at the time, I was just coming back from an injury. I just passed the fitness test. It was a night game. And David Speedy, who I've had a little bit of history with, went over the top. He caught me on the knee and it was just a case of just losing the plot a little bit.
Lastly, you played in two notable cup finals for Sunderland, unfortunately losing both. So how good does it feel? Sorry about that.
It's okay, get that in.
How good does it feel knowing that not only the silverware drought, but also the Wembley hoodoo is over for this club?
Trying to turn this ship around and get it pointing in the right direction, but there are signs that they are on the right course.
Yeah, I think it's huge. It's huge. You know, unfortunately, the only time I didn't get there in the last eight occasions, obviously with the lockdown, the go and win at Wembley. Mm. And I think, you know, obviously there's a lot of supporters who would love to have been there. But yeah, you know, hopefully this is the start of things. Hopefully the next time we are at Wembley, we can go and win again. But we all know that, you know, Sunderland at Wembley, we all know that it's going to be well supported. You know that we're going to bring at least 30,000-40,000 to Wembley and make a weekend of it. It's great. I think it's every player's dream. I think it's every supporter's dream as well to see your team walk out at Wembley. You know, as you're growing up, you know, you want to obviously play professional football, you want to play at the highest standard, you want to be involved in the big games, play against the big teams, you want to play at Wembley. These are all the things which you do dream about as a young person. So to go and obviously walk out at Wembley representing your club, you know, I had the privilege of captain at Wembley, so you know, that is huge, you know, and you know, that's something which you can't take away from myself. But also playing at Wembley in front of, you know, thousands and thousands of people is a highlight in your career which, you know, nobody can take back.
Gary, thank you so much for spending some time with us. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Been a pleasure. Take care. Thank you.
Thank you.
Davenport, Bennett, goal for Sunderland.
So, since we were last filming for FanZone,
A lot of stuff has happened. We were filmed on the 16th of April 2021, and 2 days later, arguably the biggest thing in our sport in our generation happened with the creation, or at least the concept, of a European Super League. Now, on the screen right now is all 12 clubs that were supposedly breaking away from their domestic leagues to go play in this new midweek competition starting from next season. And the consequences from that came with massive, massive impacts on not only the clubs involved, but clubs all the way down the English pyramid and other leagues in different countries. So UEFA came out with a statement and said that they would try their best to make sure that none of this can happen. And many other clubs came out in solidarity, making sure that they knew that their voice was heard and that they don't agree with the Super League. So the person who was at the helm of all of this and supposedly the ringleader of said European Super League was Real Madrid president Florentino Perez. And there was other people from different clubs like Juventus and other clubs from the Big 12, as they like to call themselves. They basically came together behind UEFA and FIFA's back to make this breakaway league. And they all had the notion that it was going to make the future of football and the future for modern fans. However, I don't think many people could have estimated what was to happen next. No one really thought they would actually go through with it. And in the last 72 to 80 hours, the backlash that this competition and format has got has been immense. Clubs big and small have come out and said that they do not agree with this at all. There's been protests outside of Anfield, the Etihad, Stamford Bridge, where Petr Cech had to go and calm all the fans down and say give them time. And as we're recording this on the 21st of April, all 6 English clubs have pulled out of the European Super League. The first being Manchester City. And it seems very out of the blue just to bring it up halfway through the show. However, I felt like it's something we had to talk about, especially how this is a show for the fans, and to not add it after the date of just filming and just moving on like it never happened wouldn't be acceptable. So the right thing to do would be to mention the Super League and to make sure that our opinion on it all has been heard. The irony is the club that the modern fan loves but the traditional fan hates in Paris Saint-Germain was actually one of the main teams to supposedly save football. Them, along with Bayern Munich and Dortmund, refused the idea of the Super League and shown that they wanted to play actual football for the fans and not just for the money. Some call it ironic, but when you look into it, it shows more that they're actually caring about the fans and what football's all about. Competition. The Premier League held a meeting with 14 of the clubs, not including the Big 6 that broke away from the Super League, and all 14 unanimously agreed the fact that it's a bad idea and they won't stand for it. It got to the point where even Tottenham sacked Mourinho for not agreeing with it. Daniel Levy came out and said that the reason they sacked Mourinho is because of a bad run of results, but fans alike, as well as pundits and reporters, know that there has to be a lot more than just a bad run of results for Spurs. A serial winner like Jose Mourinho doesn't just get sacked for a bad run of results. Perez supposedly tried to keep it going, but all of the clubs were having none of it, and rightfully so. One of the people who has to be seen as one of the main drivers of anti-Super League is former Man United player and Sky pundit Gary Neville for his emotional speech on Super Sunday. And Neville and Carragher, Souness, pretty much all of the Sky punditry team came together and said that it's not good for the future of the game. And on Match of the Day in the BBC, almost every pundit in England has come out and said that it's a bad idea. And because of this, the players started to come out, and most notably Jordan Henderson, for calling a captain's meeting in the Premier League, and they all agreed that it's a bad idea. Henderson coming out and saying that he doesn't agree with it at all and that it needs to be stopped. All of the protests shown that this was a really bad idea, but despite the fact that they've pulled out, they still need to be punished. As of yet, there's been no punishment towards the 6 clubs that said they would happily break away from the Premier League. They knew exactly what they were doing, so it wasn't just a case of they don't know what they've gotten into, because they writ a contract. Perez came and said that they all legally binded in contracts. So as of we're recording this, there hasn't been any action taken by UEFA, FIFA, the Premier League, the Super League, or any of the 12 clubs. So we'll just have to wait and see what happens. Now, back onto the actual show.
Welcome back, everyone. Are you a kit man, Joseph?
I mean, if they're, you know, heavy and round.
Joe, I said kit man.
Oh, real stuff, lads.
Well, you're in luck because there's a new market that's sweeping the world of football revolving shirts. They're called mystery boxes, and basically what they are, you pay a certain amount of money for a box which contains stuff like a random football shirt from around the world, some kind of memorabilia, sometimes a scarf, information about a club. And yeah, it's exactly what it says in the tin. It's just a mystery on what you're going to get. Have you ever purchased one before?
I bought one off Wish. I won't say what was in it.
Oh dear. Well, did you get your money back? That wasn't money well spent. Ooh. Well, as luck may have it, our team had a mystery box made of our own. So I have no clue what's in this. Should we just get this bad boy open?
Yeah, okay.
I'll let you do the honours. What we got?
So, we got Cardiff football.
Oh, very nice.
Heads. Oh. Oh, I'm feeling like a guy off TikTok. Got the Euro 2020 stickers.
Oh.
We've got a Paolo Maldini card.
From a brand we won't name.
Oh, and a... Oh, West Ham shirt.
Oh, very nice.
Oh, oh, that was. Just need J-Lings on the back. Should we open the stickers?
Yeah, why not? On your head. Oh, I missed. Right. I want to be careful because I don't want to rip the actual stickers. Right, so we've got De Bruyne and Vertonghen. We've got Martin Braithwaite, Middlesbrough and Barcelona legend.
What a player.
Cracking player. Andreas Christiansen. No one. Oh, Tyrone Mings.
Oh.
So we found an England player.
I mean, do we get 20 boxes off here?
I highly doubt it, but. Oh, well. Just put our rubbish in there.
Oh, and the Papa John's pizza box.
If you know, you know.
Well, that was exciting, wasn't it, Dom?
Yeah, it's like Christmas, that, wasn't it?
Well, you do claim to know your kits, don't you?
I'd like to think I know my stuff.
Well, I have a game for you to play. It's time to head to the appropriately named strip club.
Ooh.
So we're going to show you a collection of kits with blurred out badges.
Okay.
You'll have 60 seconds to name as many as you can, and we'll see how well you really know your kits, man.
Sounds good to me.
So, as we're nice, we'll give you the first one with no time limit.
All right.
As soon as you answer it, the 60 seconds will start counting down.
Right, got it.
Right, so here's your first kit.
Right, that is Derby County,
that
Joseph.
That is correct. So, the time has started.
Right. Notts County?
That's correct.
Oh, Chris Kamara. Samsung? Swindon?
Yep.
Kenny Miller, Yellow Park, Thistle?
Yeah, correct.
Nice one. Oh, no clue.
It's near us.
Is it? York?
Yeah.
Oh, easy, Man United.
Yep.
This could be a few teams. Darlington?
Yeah.
Oh, Ray Wilton's QPR?
Yeah.
Pass. Man City. Cardiff.
Yes.
Burnley.
Yes.
That's Palmer.
Yes.
Birmingham City.
Yes. Well, that is unfortunately your time up.
How many did I get?
You got 14.
Oh, well.
So, you know.
I'll take that.
Very well.
Well, unfortunately, that's all we've got time for today. It's been a wild ride. It's been fun. We've learnt a lot.
Yep, we learnt that I like kit men.
K- kits. Definitely kits.
And that wish mystery boxes should not be purchased.
Definitely.
Under any circumstances.
Not one. But on that bombshell, it's time to end. See y'all later. Don't go changing.